subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with India, which is leading the global fight against the COVID-19. While its multi-layered approach against the pandemic has helped it contain the infection rate at home, the vaccines produced in India are curing the world. Millions of doses have already been airlifted to several countries in South Asia and other parts of the world, making India a savior in times of crisis.
Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, the Maldives, Bhutan and the Himalayan nation Nepal. The countries across South Asia and many other parts of the world have received millions of Made in India vaccine doses to begin their immunization programs. This comes as New Delhi has rolled out a two-pronged strategy to save its own citizens and the people across the world from the deadly pandemic. Over 5 million doses were flown this week to different parts of the world, with millions set to be transported in coming days. India, popular as the pharmacy of the world, has already agreed to supply more than 1 billion coronavirus vaccines to various countries and to the World Health Organization-backed COVAX initiative aimed at supporting poorer countries. Observers say that many low-income countries that have launched their immunization programs would have been waiting for aid or were bargaining for prices had it not been New Delhi that exported vaccines, most of which have been free till date, just 4 days after its domestic immunization began. The Himalayan nation of Nepal launched its largest immunization campaign with its first coronavirus vaccination for medical workers following a gift of 1 million doses from New Delhi.
हामीले छिटै नै यस खोपको सुरुवात गर्ने मौका पायौँ यसका निम्ति हाम्रो छिमेकी मित्र राष्ट्र भारत सरकार भारतका जनता र खास गरी महामहिम प्रधानमन्त्री नरेन्द्र मोदीजी प्रति म धन्यवाद भन्न चाहन्छु कि उहाँहरूले आफूले सुरु गरेको हप्ता दिनभित्रै जसो हामीले सुरु गर्न सक्ने गरी हामीलाई 10 लाख डोज उपलब्ध गराउनु भएको छ त्यही पनि डोनेसनमा
The safety and immunogenicity of India-produced vaccines received a major acknowledgement when Brazil asked for its over Chinese vaccines, which they say have the efficacy of just 50%. New Delhi itself has launched the world's biggest immunization program of inoculating 300 million people in next 6 months. The international community, from the United Nations to the USA, believes that India has been at the forefront in fighting the pandemic and preventing an even worse crisis the deadly disease could have afflicted. While it is currently manufacturing 2 vaccines, the AstraZeneca Oxford vaccine and one developed by the Indian pharmaceutical firm Bharat Biotech, 3 other Indian companies are close to wrapping up development of their own vaccines.
अभी तो सिर्फ दो मेड इन इंडिया कोरोना वैक्सीन दुनिया में आई है, आने वाले समय में कई और वैक्सीन भारत से बनकर के आने वाली है। ये वैक्सीन दुनिया के देशों को और ज्यादा बड़े स्केल पर ज्यादा स्पीड से मदद करने में ये पूरी तरह सहायता करेगी।
While many countries across the world are still reeling under the pandemic, India has contained the spread of the infections, with 20% of its region not reporting even a single case in the last few days. With all preventive measures in place, the life of the market seems to have returned, with the country projected to rebound on the losses it accrued during the crisis. The International Monetary Fund says India will be the only country in the world in the next 1 year to register a double-digit growth rate. Experts say that it won't be an overstatement if India is labeled as the country that has managed the crisis best in the world thus far.
Moving on to war torn Afghanistan, where amid rising violence and killings, a story of passion and hope has surfaced. Manizha Talash, a high school student, has toppled conservative barriers to break into the world of breakdancing, a phenomenon that is considered foreign by religious hardliners and is a taboo for Afghan women. However, Talash, who is bent at building a career in this dance form come sport, remains unfazed and is tirelessly pursuing her dream of representing her country in 2024 Paris Olympics.
A gym in downtown Kabul is the place where resolute Manizha Talash and her teammates jump and sway to the beat, working up a sweat break dancing and doing head spins. In a society torn by escalating violence, Talash has overcome stiff resistance from both society and family to burst onto the scene of this dance form come sport. And now, many others too have followed the lead of braving and breaking the conservatism. When she first joined the breakdancing club about 2.5 months ago, there were no girls there. Now it has 5. She hopes many more will join.
مثلا این رشته تازه شروع شده و دختر نداشت و یک رشته متفاوت است و من علاقه زیاد داشتم که به این رشته حتما بیایم و قبلا چون نبود همین که خبر شدم اینجا رشته اومده در افغانستان و بچهای خودم از کابل هستن از افغانستان هستن و خیلی خوش شدم اومدم که این رشته را به مردم دیگه نشان بدم که رشته جدید هم اومده در افغانستان و میخوایم متفاوت باشه.
Anybody familiar with the US dance style would have ruled out its success in the war-torn country a few years back. Thanks to country's history, battered by Taliban's ultra-hardline rule till 2001. Women were not allowed to receive education or leave the house without a male relative under Taliban control. Things have changed since its ouster, but the psyche of a large section of the society is yet to accept women in modern roles and fields. However, determined Afghan women like Talash have gone on to accomplish their goals despite all the barriers. Talash aspires to represent her country in the Olympics, where breakdancing will be a medal event from 2024.
مردم همیشه انرژی منفی میتن گپای مثبت نمیزنن بلکه منفی میزنن مثلا که ما مسلمان هستیم و رقص در افغانستان گناه است چون اسلام است ما مسلمان هستیم و یک کشور اسلامی است مثلا بعضی هاشون مرا تهدید کردن که اگه گیر ما بیایی را توته توته میکنیم و از این گپا خب ولی من نمیخوایم که بازم منصرف شویم.
Taliban, which is now engaged with the government in the intra-Afghan dialogue, has hinted of a better life to women on its return to mainstream. However, peace doesn't seem to be returning anytime sooner in the country, with the insurgents escalating offensive despite an ongoing peace process. Afghan Human Rights Commission says that 2020 was the deadliest years for Afghans, when around 8 civilians were killed every day. With US troops withdrawing rapidly and a fresh Washington policy in waiting, the challenges for the less experienced Afghan security system are only going to become bigger. This might have pushed the future of Afghan women towards uncertainty, but they are just not ready to back down. They say they are ready to take every challenge head on.
If there was a book containing tricks of exploitation, then Pakistan would be its author. Hundreds of thousands of kilometers of land has not just been illegally occupied, but it is constantly being plundered by Islamabad. No wonder people protest. Hundreds of them recently took to streets in Gilgit-Baltistan, where Islamabad had grabbed the land in the name of dams, but never involved the locals in the employment opportunities that emerged out of it.
Resentment is at its peak among the locals of illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan, especially those living in Diyamar. These people sacrificed their lands and homes for the Diyamar Dam project, but when it came on authorities to pay back by appointing them at various posts in the project, they just neglected them completely and allotted the jobs to Pakistani people. To raise their voice against this discrimination, a huge protest was organized by the Graduate Alliance Diyamar, which was also joined by the activists of political parties and locals. Demonstrators marched from DC Chowk to Wapada office in Chilas, wherein they chanted slogans against Pakistan's Water and Power Development Authority and accused it for violating the agreement that it signed with the dam-affected people. They even demanded the establishment of Diyamar Technical Institution, an engineering university, and upgradation of Regional Medical Hospital Chilas to a medical college.
ये सिर्फ दियामर का मसला नहीं है, ये पूरे गिलगित-बल्तिस्तान का मसला है। यहाँ पे सिर्फ जाब की बात नहीं है, जाब के साथ साथ हमारे दियामर को वहाँ पे यूनिवर्सिटीज बननी चाहिए, मेडिकल कॉलेजेस बनने चाहिए। ये वापडा ने हर जगह पे, जहाँ पे वापडा का जहाँ पे डैम बना है, वहाँ पे ये सारी मतलब सहूलियत दिए हैं उन लोगों को, लेकिन हमारे दियामर के साथ बिलखसूस ये बहुत ज्यादती हो रही है।
Located on the Indus River in northern Pakistan, between Kohistan district in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa and Diyamar district of Gilgit-Baltistan, Diyamar Bhasha Dam is going to generate 4,500 megawatt of electricity and is expected to complete by 2028. Earlier, thousands of locals were rendered homeless as Pakistan acquired their lands for its dream project and paid them mere pennies in the name of compensation. And now it has stooped to a new low by keeping them deprived of employment opportunities.
उनकी जमीनें अधिक कीमत पे वसूल करने के बाद अभी उनके नौकरियों का और उनके जो जायज मुतालिबात है उनको टोकरी में रख के अपने पसंदीदा कैंडिडेट्स डोन कंट्री से ला के दियामर वाबड़ा में अपनी अजदारी कायम करने चाहते हैं। हम उनको कंडम करते हैं और पुरजोर अल्फाज में मुजम्मत भी करते हैं।
दो दियामर भाषा डैम प्रोजेक्ट वाज इन्विजिज्ड 40 इयर्स बैक, इट कुड नॉट बिकम अ रियलिटी as Pakistan didn't have the required funds to complete it. Lately, Pakistan has even signed a contract with China Power, Chinese state-run firm, and Frontier Workers Organization, a commercial arm of Pakistan's military, to get its construction done. But as the Chinese firm has 70% stake in this joint venture, Pakistan, in short, has allowed increased footprints of its ally, in illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan, which will further deteriorate the living conditions of the locals and make their life a living hell.
Moving on to Nepal, where the group of Sherpas that became the first team ever to climb K2, the second highest peak in winters, received heroes' welcome on their return to home. The 10-man team climbed 8,611-meter K2 peak on 16th of this month. The K2 peak was climbed for the first time in 1954 and saw 6 winter attempts before this one, all ending in failure.
This group of men receiving cheers upon its landing at the Kathmandu airport has scripted history. They are climbers who have made the first successful winter summit of K2, the world's second tallest peak that turns deadly in winters owing to its treacherous and steep terrain. Fans and family who were edgy along their expedition placed colorful Buddhist prayer scarves on the climber's shoulders on their arrival. They call them heroes. And heroes they are, for they are the first in many others who tried ascending K2 but failed. Some even lost their lives. Nirmal Purja, a famous mountaineer and the climbing leader of this Sherpa group, attributed their success to team spirit and a resolve to raise their country's pride.
As a team, we feel really proud, we feel really honored, and I think we send a really clear message to the world. If you unite, nothing is impossible. So everybody's happy here, and thank you so much for all the press and all our friends for being here today this morning. Thank you so much.
Their success was marred by the death on the mountain of renowned Spanish climber Sergi Minguet, who fell down a crevasse as he attempted to make his way down to base camp. From Prime Minister K.P. Sharma Oli to the common citizens of the country, everybody congratulated the team for making their country proud. The mountain was first climbed in 1954 but had never been summited in the winter. The Sherpas, people belonging to a Nepalese ethnicity, however, were confident of making it this time. Earlier, the climbing leader Nirmal Purja, who holds the record of climbing the world's 14 highest mountains in the shortest time of 6 months and 1 week, said the K2 ascent was a huge achievement for all climbers to celebrate.
In bigger mission like this, if you are not confident, then who's going to be? And then if you are not confident, why you are there? And as long as you believe here and you believe in your chest, just go for it. And this is a simple message in life. There are so many things. And this is like K2 winter, but this is not about climbing K2 winter. In all your life, we all have our own mountain to climb. As long as you believe in yourself, and then you give it from your hair and here, everything is possible.
Nepal, commonly known as the Himalayan nation, homes some of the tallest peak in the world. The Nepal-Tibet border roughly follows the line of the highest part of the range of the Great Himalayas, featuring several of the world's highest peaks. From Mount Everest to Kanchenjunga to Annapurna, these permanently snow-capped mountains overlook huge glaciers. Thousands of climbers land in Nepal from across the world to make their ascent bids. While many fail, there are few who inscribe their initials at the highest point on Earth.
Moving on to our cultural section, where we'll take you to explore the Rajarani Music Festival that imbibes the tradition and culture of Eastern Indian state of Odisha. Organized in capital Bhubaneswar, the festival was conceptualized in such a way that it acts as the perfect platform for classical Indian music. Held in the backdrop of Rajarani Temple, the festival mesmerized the audience.
Odisha is known for its ancient temples and rich culture, which is always reflected in the fairs and festivals. Recently, the melodious Raja Rani Music Festival was organized in the state capital, Bhubaneswar, that celebrates the charishma of Odissi, the classical music form of Odisha. The music event was held in the lush green ambience in the precinct of the magnificent Raja Rani Temple. Artists from across the country participated in the three-day music festival. The festival, which is organized every year, features seasoned and promising vocalists and instrumentalists.
Three-day festival, it always places all the three styles of classical music, Hindustani music, Carnatic music, and Odissi music. All the three classical music style, their vocal and instrumental is presented very nicely. And this year, after the COVID, people are very happy because everybody had a doubt whether it could be organized, but it is organized so well and the ambience is so beautiful.
The festival celebrated the richness of Indian classical music and provides a good opportunity for budding artists as well. Against the backdrop of the Raja Rani Temple, the musical evenings of this festival is dazzling with performances by renowned instrumentalists and vocalists of India. The audience were swept away after listening to the euphonious music.
Dating back to the 11th century, this radiant temple is so inspiring, and I think it's one of a kind because the ambience that is being created here for especially a musical concert is something remarkable. I'm extremely grateful to the festival organizers.
The key highlights of the festival were the genius of Hindustani, Carnatic, Sufi, and Odisha's homegrown Odissi music. The festival attracted a large number of locals as well as tourists.
It's a simply fantastic experience with the Raja Rani Temple at the background and the international artists performing before a very enlightened audience. It's simply fantastic. No words can explain the experience. And I think the artist must be feeling proud of such an audience and such an atmosphere as well.
The festival falls back to the age-old tradition of music, which is the cornerstone of spirituality. Today, these types of cultural festivals have successfully created a good space for themselves in the cultural map of the country by bringing numerous talented artists on a single platform and have helped Bhubaneswar emerge as a top classical music destination in the country.
Such festivals have played a crucial role in building the Indian heritage. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.